After cycling around Europe from Ireland to Morocco, then up to Scandinavia, and down through Eastern Europe here to Istanbul, it is now time to embark on an overland expedition. After enjoying Istanbul and buying boots, we will now go and join a very rough and ready Middle East expedition and get on our way for 6 weeks of incredible sights and sounds. As is the norm with tough overland adventures of this type, the participants are mainly Australasian, with a few English and South African. We had to camp in this wet and miserable place last night, as the original site we set up in to camp was not allowed by the Turkish police, so they moved us. We think there were some very shady dealings going on. We are now on our way to experience the tragedy that was and is a very emotional place for any Australian or New Zealander, Gallipoli. Upon the news that Britain had declared war on Germany in 1914, there were hundreds of thousands of Australians and New Zealanders keen to enlist in the ANZAC army in order to have an overseas adventure at the cost of the government. Although the ANZAC had it fairly tough building their own countries compared to their yet-to-be-unknown enemy, who lived a much tougher life, the ANZACs were to be fooled by their commanding officers, who were really the British.
This is actually where the ANZACs landed. Not as smooth beach as they predicted.
This is known as the Sphinx by the ANZACs, down on the beach.
Hardly the overseas adventure they had sought, but to be herded in a fateful place called Gallipoli, which no one had ever heard of before 1915, and hardly at the head of the main front. The mission, organized by the French and British, where they were going to block the exit from the Maramis Sea. The Turks soon took care of that attempt, which left the Allies no choice but to carry out a land attack to capture Turkey and destroy the Ottoman Empire. Not only did they get the wrong beach, but the Turks were waiting and bogged the Anzacs down for what was to be a slow torture of trench warfare, which left the Anzacs demoralized and beaten by a determined Turkish force led by a new hero, Ataturk, who later changed Turkey from a deeply rooted Islamic state into a proud, secularized, forward-thinking country. The Anzacs and the Turkish people, even today, have a lasting respect for each other and a deep friendship that came from that ill-conceived battle. At night, the opposing forces would declare a ceasefire, whilst both sides would reclaim their dead and injured and would sing songs to each other and exchange Turkish delights and goodies that the Anzacs had. The next morning, of course, the killing would continue.
This is a recreation of the trenches they used during the First World War. It's freezing cold now, and that's what they would have had to put up with. It's muddy and slushy and cold, and this was actually the positioning of the trenches during the First World War. They surrounded this whole hilltop. It was the strategic hilltop of the whole campaign, really, because over there you can see the Dardanelles and the Salt Lake on the other side.
This is celebrations for the 75th anniversary of the Turkish Republic. This is a stadium near Ephesus. Ephesus is across the road. We'll go across there later on.
It's also a celebration for Kemal Ataturk, one of the great figures of the 20th century. Ataturk rescued the surviving Turkish remnant of the defeated Ottoman Empire at the end of World War I. He galvanized his people against invading Greek forces who sought to impose the Allied will upon the war-weary Turks and repulsed aggression by British, French and Italian troops. Through these struggles he founded the modern Republic of Turkey, for which he is still revered by the Turks. He succeeded in restoring to his people pride in their Turkishness, coupled with a new sense of accomplishment as their backward nation was brought into the modern world. Over the next two decades, Ataturk created a modern state that would grow under his successes into a viable democracy.
Biter. Kur. Ephesus, Turkey.
Hercules Gate. The Fountain of Trajan, the fountain on the right side of Curator Street, was built in the 2nd century AD and dedicated to Emperor Trajan. The Temple of Hadrian, the most attractive edifice on Curator Street, built in the 2nd century AD. Public toilets, just side by side in the public latrine. Inside the brothel. Not much activity at the moment, I must admit. We'll keep looking, however. We might fire a few employees. There's one. She's been waiting for 2,000 years for customers. Still waiting. The Library of Celsus, built between 117 and 120 AD for Julius Celsus Polyarmenes. The library being next to the Gate of Marsyas and Mithridates. Sophia, which is the Virtues of Wisdom. Three other statues, Knowledge, Virtue and Destiny. This is the edge of the Agora, and we're heading off to the 25,000 seater. All marble flooring along here. This theatre holds 25,000 people and was built around the 3rd century AD. Looks out onto what used to be the sea coming up. There's a lake nearby, and rivers, of course, which led to the sea, which was not a long way away. Pedestrian street leading away from the theatre used to be lined with shops in the 4th century, named after the Emperor Arcadius. Looking back from Arcadia to the theatre. Oh, horse-drawn carriage all the way into Salchim. Riveting. Andy's just going to get some cotton now as we head towards eastern Turkey. What's it like to... feels like cotton wool. Yeah, it's cotton wool. From the cotton fields in the distance to Pumakakal. Thermal pools. Let's line this hill.
Panoramic view of everything, and we're off to a
town called Kach, which is at the
probably the southernmost point of Turkey. And there we'll stay a couple of days and camp out as usual.
Taking away the evil spirits, man. That's what these eyes do.
Gives you the evil eye, man.
Yeah.
In the theatre of Maria, here we are. Loving the acoustics every day. They can hear me at the top because it's a concrete block. And the sound travels everywhere.
These old ancient houses from the 5th century BC. Open to the rocks and the hills.
Hello.
The old ruins of Olympus.
Is that them?
As he battles on.
Is that the way to go, dog? He says, go that way.
Yes, free camping on the stilts, one could call them that.
Camping right on the beach at Olympus, when right in front of us, in front of the tent, the snake is playing around, while the others just returned from the eternal flame on the top of the hill.
What's your buy?
On the way to Cappadocia, these incredible mountains in the middle of nowhere. In this rugged country of southeastern Turkey.
لما كلمني بحنية نده ليا بيقول اتقل. قلبي ملك أمري يا نور الدنيا يا قمري لما كلمني بحنية نده ليا بيقول اتقط جن مني
Stuck in a roadblock on top of this mountain. It's not exactly an easy way back.
It's going to be several hours, I think, getting us through there.
Yeah, but it'll take us
this guy won't know
a long time.
Cappadocia is no joke. People still live in these conical-shaped limestone structures and have done for many hundreds of years.
يا حبيبي خلاص ما بقينا اتنين